So electrolysis is driving non-spontaneous reactions to occur by putting in electricity. This is what you do every single time you charge a battery, charge your cell phone. You are plugging it into an electrical source. It is pumping electrons in and forcing the reaction to occur in the opposite direction. So we're going to examine that process. All right, and that's what it says. The process in which electrical energy, electricity, is used to cause a non-spontaneous chemical reaction to occur. An electrolytic cell is what we use, and let's just talk a little bit about that name. Electrolysis means to, lysis is to break apart, okay, to cleave, and you're using electricity to split apart. It was used originally and is used most often to take a compound and break it apart into its elements. Spontaneously, elements combine to form products, and that's, compounds, that's the word. That occurs typically spontaneously, and if you want to take that compound that you found in nature and get back the elements, you can split it apart into elements. So that is where it gets its name. Now here's an electrolytic cell, and this is the one used for splitting water. We see that water is placed in there. We see a voltage source down here at the bottom. It has to be a direct current. It's got to be not an alternating current like comes out of our plugs in the walls. You have to have a direct source of flow, so it's pumping in one direction. You have a cathode where you're going to have reduction occur, and an anode where you're going to have oxidation occur. You'll see the sign convention is opposite for reasons that we might get into, we'll see, okay? But you've got to pump that in, okay? Up here what we see is a added thing that's not part of the reaction, it's sulfuric acid. Water is not a very good conductor of electricity. There's very few ions present. So you tend to want to add an electrolyte into your solution. So that is what the sulfuric acid is. It's an electrolyte added to the water that will allow the electrons to flow. So they're going to be a movement of electricity through this cell down across that bottom bar of blue water going between the cathode and the anode. Okay, now why can't it just be anything? Well, you could add something that makes it conduct electricity very well, but itself would become electrolyzed, and you would not necessarily want that to happen. We want only, in this case, the water to be split apart and not the electrolyte that you add in there to have it conduct electricity. It seems like sodium chloride might be an obvious choice. So we have, you know, salt, water, conduct electricity, but you would end up producing chlorine gas, and that would not be pleasant whatsoever. So let's look at the reactions that are taking place at the electrodes, okay, for both the anode and for the cathode. So to write the reactions at the anode and the cathode, we have to consider what's occurring, and it's not as straightforward as you might think, but we do know that at the anode, there is going to be oxidation occurring, and I see in my diagram that oxygen gas is being generated, okay? So here's the half reaction of what's happening at the anode. The water molecules, okay, and I'm going ahead and balancing it as a balanced half reaction, is going to be producing oxygen, but we don't just have that. It needs to be a balanced redox reaction. And you could go through all the process of writing a balanced redox reaction if you wanted to, but I will just go ahead and write it for you. To balance the hydrogens, we had to add H+. Okay, that's aqueous, and then to balance the charges, we have our electrons. So this is what is occurring at the anode. We are generating oxygen gas. At the cathode, we are also using water, okay? So, I don't know if it's a two. We have the water, and it is generating hydrogen gas, okay? Now, not intuitive that it's just one mole of hydrogen gas. There is an OH- being generated as well, Okay, two hydrogens, we need four hydrogens, so we're going to put a two right there. And then we're going to have to gain our electrons, and I didn't leave room for my gaining of electrons, so let us gain our electrons. If I have two OH minuses, I have two minuses on this side, I'm going to have two electrons on this side. So this is the half reaction, that is the reduction. So this is happening at the cathode, and we see that generating hydrogen on the right-hand side of our apparatus. I cannot add these two half cells together unless the number of electrons lost and the number of electrons gained are the same. So what we have to do is we have to multiply this one times two. And I'm going to go ahead and rewrite it, okay? That gives me four waters plus four electrons, gives me two H2 gas plus four OH minus. So this is no more. I'll just put a line through it. Well, you can't see that line. Neither can I. So that one we're not going to consider. We're going to consider this one. Now we're ready to add these two reactions together. This is gaining electrons, reduction. Reduction happens at the cathode. Now when we add these two half reactions together, we can cancel out things that are the same on both sides and bring everything else down. The only thing that's the same is the four electrons. Okay? And I'll draw a line, see if it'll write. Yeah, there we go. Now let's bring everything down together. I see nothing else that can cancel. Two waters plus four waters is six waters. Is there anything else on the left-hand side? No, okay. On the right-hand side, I've got my oxygen. Okay, I've got my hydrogen. I'm going to go ahead and write those next to each other for a reason. We'll see here in just a minute. I got my four H pluses and my four OH minuses. Okay, when we balanced redox reactions, what did we do when we saw something like that? We turned those into waters. So that's four water molecules. These four water molecules will cancel with four of these water molecules and leave me with two. So my overall reaction looks like this. Canceling all of those, leaving me two behind. Two waters produces O2 gas plus H2 gas. So that is the overall reaction, but the half reactions are not intuitive for us, okay? In order to see the electrons transferred in a half reaction, this is how they are written. All right, now let's look at these numbers. Notice 1 mole of this and 2 moles of that. Go back and look at that apparatus. You're generating, they show it nicely in this diagram, twice as much hydrogen gas as you are oxygen gas, and that should make sense. They're both being collected at the same atmospheric pressure, so you would have twice the volume of this as you would have of this. If we go back and remember our gas laws, okay, that's Avogadro's law, where you can treat those coefficients as volumes and have that same ratio. Okay, so that is an example of an electrolytic cell. Let's look at another example of electrolytic cell. We've got molten sodium chloride, okay? It looks like it's sitting in a glass vat. It's not. We're just looking through it here. You take some sodium chloride and you raise the temperature enough to melt it, okay? And then you do the same thing. You pump electrons in. At the anode, you would have oxidation occur. Look down there at the very bottom, left-hand side, we see that the chloride ions are turning into chlorine gas and they would bubble away, okay? On the right-hand side, it's the cathode, and the cathode is having electrons gained, okay? So they're coming into that cathode side, and we have the sodium, and it would not be a solid sodium because this has had a high temperature. It would be liquid sodium. The liquid sodium would be less dense than the sodium chloride, and it kind of floats up to the top and can be collected off. In terms of electrolysis of reactive metals like this, the way you would want to get sodium metal is by electrolysis. Prior to this, trying to come up with pure sodium metal by way of chemical reactions, very difficult because you're trying to force electrons onto sodium, and sodium does not want electrons. But we can easily force them on by pumping electricity in. We are forcing a non-spontaneous process to occur. All right, so the overall reaction for this one, I will write here with these reactions. We've got the two electrons and the two electrons canceling, okay? So we would have the 2Cl minus plus 2Na plus turning into Cl2 gas plus 2Na, and it will be a liquid in this case, okay? So that is what is occurring. And notice I don't have aqueous with these guys because this is not water. You cannot do this reaction in water and expect to collect these products. And we'll talk about why here in just a minute. You do have those present if you were to dissolve salt in water. You would have those ions present, but you have a competition between the water and the sodium chloride, and who is going to actually end up forming is a big question. So that would be the overall reaction and a good way of collecting any of your reactive metals. If you look at your 1A and 2A metals and even aluminum, the best way to gain those metals, to purify or to obtain a metal out of a compound, is with this electrolysis process. Okay, so I told you that, you know, if you were to dump sodium chloride in water, you wouldn't necessarily get the products you want. I'm doing an example of dumping some sodium bromide instead of sodium chloride in water. There are two choices of things that could happen. Maybe the Br- reacts and forms some Br, and it wouldn't be a gas. Well, it depends. It's probably going to be a liquid. Depending on what temperature it runs at. So we'll change that to an L. Or maybe at the anode, you would have this reaction happening with the water, okay? Those are our choices of what could happen at the anode if you put sodium bromide in water and did electrolysis. At the cathode, we would have the competition between the sodium cation that's in the salt, or would it be the water? There's going to be a competition. Now, what's going to happen here? We have each electrode. The choice is going to be the one that's easiest to force the electron to do this thing, okay? In both cases, look up here at the anode, okay? The question is it easier to force bromide ions? Bromide is happy as Br minus. Is it easier to force it to become bromine, the element? Or is it easier to force water to give you oxygen? That is the question. And at the cathode, the question is it easier to say sodium ion? I know you're happy that way, but I want to force an electron on you. Or is it easier to take water and say, you know what, I want to force an electron on you and turn you into hydrogen gas? The way you do this is to come up with the cell potentials for the reactions that you see there. And you're going to find the one that's easiest to force the electrons to do their thing, force them off or force them in on, depending on whether it's an anode or the cathode. And this is typically the one that's closest to zero. So I went to a table of reduction potentials. At the anode, these are oxidation. So I found the reaction, but it was the reverse of this one, right? When I go to my tables, they are all reduction potentials on the table. But these reactions are oxidation. So I took the value and I changed the sign and it gave me these two values. Which one's closer to zero? Well, this one is closer to zero. So rather than water being oxidized, the Br- would be oxidized and you would be forming some bromine, okay? At the cathode, we would compare these two values. We have to force the electrons to do what it doesn't want to do spontaneously. And the one that has the closest to zero voltage is the one that's going to be easier to force. And so in this case, you would get the hydrogen gas generated. So if you took the sodium bromide at the anode, you would be collecting Br-. And at the cathode, you would be collecting the hydrogen gas. And that's what you would generate. So this would be an example that you would not want to use sodium bromide back in the water electrolysis process. And I'm going to quickly flip back to it, okay? Here's the water. In this one, we would not want to use the sodium bromide because the sodium bromide would start generating bromine gas and not what you were wanting to collect, okay? So you chose us, we use the sulfuric acid instead. All right, get all our numbers back there. Now there is a little funky thing, and if you're watching videos or reading in the textbook, you might read something about overvoltage. Overvoltage is a complicating factor that will allow sometimes things that are close to, not, you don't get what's predicted. And we are not going to discuss overvoltage. So if you run across this, you can be happy that we're not going to cover that. So this is all of this lesson, and all we have to talk about in terms of the process of electrolysis.